Okay, welcome back again. So in this session, we are going to mainly discuss about the centroids or how to find centroids of planar area. So our attention would be, mostly on the planar area, and that is why we use the term centroid. Remember, the center of gravity, or also known as center of mass, that can be applied to three-dimensional bodies. So, as we all know, that that Earth exerts a gravitational force on each of the particles forming a body, and consider how your weight is distributed throughout your body. These forces can be replaced by a single equivalent force that is equal to the weight of the body and applied at the center of gravity for the body. Now, so therefore, in a three-dimensional system, we use the term center of gravity. However, for a planar area, it is typically known as a centroid, or rather center of area. Remember, to find out the centroid, the concept that comes into play is the first moment of an area should be used to find out the location of centroid. Now, why we are doing this analysis? As we have said in the previous session, that most of the engineering analysis will involve distributed loads. You can think of an example of a, let's say, dam. So, where you have, the water pressure is being distributed in a triangular fashion, because as you go down the depth, then your pressure will also vary in proportional to the depth. Okay. So, in this way, we can say that in order to replace those kind of distributed force system by a single force, we should know the centroid of the distributed load. So, ultimately, what is important is that area under the distributed load, that should be the resultant force or the single load that we are looking for, and its location should be at the centroid of this distributed load. So, we will try to expedite this session, assuming that most of us are familiar with this subject. In fact, students have done already some kind of they should have some familiarity with the topic. So, ultimately, remember, the concept comes from the equivalent system. If we are talking about a center of gravity of a plate, let's say, so plate means it's a thin body, and let us assume that thickness is uniform everywhere. Okay. So, now I can discretize this plate in small area, and therefore, for each area I have this delta w. Okay. So, finally, what is happening if we can see from the equivalent system perspective? So, this system, which is considered to be distributed load, and load is simply proportional to the area. Remember that the load is not varying with the distance. It is proportional to the area, but it is not proportional to either x or y. That may happen in some situations as well. So, if we consider this, so therefore, we can say that if you discretize it into small area, then the moment of this system, right, about the x and y axis should be equals to the moment produced by the resultant system. So, this is the total weight of the body that is passing through the centroid g, let us say center of gravity g. So, then we can simply use the equivalent system concept to say that the location of the center of gravity along the x direction, so that is represented by x bar. So, x bar multiplied by w should be equals to sum of moment due to the individual weights of this small small area. So, in an integration fashion we can write x dw. Similarly, if we equate the moment about x axis, we will get y bar w equals to integral y dw. So, for the line of if we want to find out the center of gravity of an wire, the same process follows, except for the fact in this case I have a line element, here I have a area element. Okay. So, ultimately using these two formulas we can find the centroids, center of gravity in this case. So, centroid is nothing but we just take, as I said, that you can buy that concept of center of gravity. Basically then what we have, if we think of it's a thin plate, then W can be replaced by the specific weight multiplied by area multiplied by thickness. Okay. So, in this way what we can get rid of, basically the specific weight gamma multiplied by T. So, ultimately what we have, x bar A should be equals to integral x dA. So, this is my first moment, as we can see the first moment with respect to y. So, that will give me x bar. Similarly, the first moment with respect to x axis will give the y bar. Using the same analogy, instead of the area A, we can think of line element, let's say delta L. Okay. So, in this way again we can say what is the weight of this delta L, that is simply equals to gamma, that is the specific weight, multiplied by the area, cross sectional area of this element, multiplied by dL. So, volume multiplied by specific weight, so that will give me the small weight, right. So, finally from the both sides again gamma A will be cancelling out. So, we get x bar L equals to integral x dL and y bar L equals to integral y dL. So, we can find out the position of the centroid from our predefined axis x and y. So, what it eventually means that if we locate the centroid and if you have the centroidal axis, that means first moment about the centroidal axis has to be equals to 0. So, with respect to the centroidal axis, the first moment must be equals to 0. Okay. So, if we look at this concept particularly, that if we think of the first moment of areas, so what is being displayed in this slide is that can you find out the cross section which are symmetric. How do I find out cross section are symmetric? So, look at the first example. The first example is here. So, an area is symmetric with respect to an axis BB prime. So, this area can be called to be symmetric with respect to an axis BB prime if for every point P there exists a point P prime such that PP prime is perpendicular to BB prime and is divided into two equal parts BB prime. That means this cross section will now be symmetric about BB prime. And therefore, the centroid of this cross section should be at this line. We can clearly see the first moment has to be equals to 0 about this axis. The reason being, if we consider from the line BB prime, if I have an area located at some distance, let's say D, then the other area is located at some distance negative D. Okay. And when you take the first moment, then ultimately A times D multiplied by A times minus D, that will cancel out. So, we get the 0 first moment about the BB prime, which is the axis of symmetry. Similarly, in this case we can clearly see the line of symmetry is this, and therefore, the centroid has to be at the in this axis OOI. Now look at this problem. If an area possesses two lines of symmetry, so in this problem we have two lines of symmetry, its centroid lies at their intersection. Okay. And at the third, remember, if we just look at this particular cross section, it looks like asymmetrical, isn't that? But ultimately, we can again say that with respect to center O, if we just observe with respect to center O, if there is an element dA at xy, then there is an element dA prime at the negative x minus y. Therefore, if you try to take the first moment about the x axis or first moment about the y axis, both will be equals to 0. Therefore, the centroid will be at the intersection of the x and y axis, which is the O. Okay. So, how do I determine the centroid by integration? So, this is a direct method to find out the centroid of different types of shapes. And as we have seen that our basic formula is x bar A should be equals to integral x dA. Now remember, if I want to break the dA into dx and dy, right, that's my small element dx and dy, then I have to all the time perform a double integration. So to avoid this, what is usually done, the dA is defined as a thin rectangle or strip. So that means now what is happening, if we have this, if we want to locate the centroid of this shape, then we will take the dA as a thin strip, which could be like this. So it has its own centroid, right? So when we take the moment of this particular strip, then we have to basically look at what is the centroid of this strip from the x axis as well as from the y axis. So we should be able to understand, rather, for this element, which is an infinitesimally small element, what is the centroid of that from the y axis, that is the x bar element, and what is the centroid of this, that is the y bar element. So we can clearly see, if I have to now, if the the line is known here, so it is defined by some pxy, let's say the shape is defined properly, then if I use a vertical strip like this, then we can say that x bar times a, that is the x bar I am trying to determine, so I have to take the moment about the y axis, right? So if I do that, then I have x bar element dA. So now what is my x bar element? X bar element in this case equals to x, and the area is y dx. Similarly, if I take the moment of this strip about the x axis in order to find out the y bar, that is the centroid of the area, then I should do y bar element is nothing but y over 2, right? Because this strip, remember, is of length y and width dx. Okay, so because defined by a point pxy. So now I have choice to do this. So I can either have a vertical strip or either I can have a horizontal strip. So if we use a horizontal strip, then you see we'll try to complicate it. So it is clearly displayed here. Now if I have to find out, let's say, what is the centroid x bar, okay, so x location of the centroid, then I have to find out first that what is the x bar of the element. So in this case, x bar of the element should be equals to a, right, plus x divided by 2, okay. And the strip area is already defined, that is a minus x multiplied by dy, where dy is the width. Okay. Similarly, we can see what is the y bar element. Y bar element will be simply y. Okay. So finally, we have to use this integration. Remember, to perform this integration now, since we have taken the integration limit along the y direction, so I need to convert, or I have to use x as a function of y. So once we substitute x in terms of y, then I can do the integration from, let's say, 0 to some height as it is given in the problem. Similarly for this, there are problems, especially when you look at a circular area, or maybe a sector, circular sector. In that way, it will be more appropriate to have a triangular element rather than vertical or horizontal element. So if I use a triangular element, so certainly what would be important, now we have changed it to the polar coordinate r theta. So the my integration will operate from 0 to r and 0 to theta, okay, or defined by the limits of r and theta. So in the triangular element, what we have is that, what is the center of this triangle. So we can clearly see that in order to find out the x bar, so I have to take the moment of this triangular strip about the y axis. So I have to find what is q y, right, in order to get the x bar. So to do the q y, how do I do that? Okay, so now you look at x bar element. So x bar element, we can clearly see that it should be 2r by 3 distance if we go in the r direction, and the component of that should be 2r cosine theta, 2r by 3 cosine theta as it is written here. Okay. So that's my x bar element, and what is the area? Area should be defined by this area of this triangle, which is nothing but, remember, this is r d theta, that's the base, and height would be equals to r, so ultimately half r square d theta. Okay, so now you can easily use the integration limit from 0 to theta in order to find out the x bar. Okay, similarly for the to get the centroid y bar, we have to see that what is the y bar of the element. So y bar of the element is nothing but 2r by 3 sine theta, and area remains the same, that is half r square d theta. So these are the basic procedure in order to find out the centroid of an area, that we can choose either the vertical strip, horizontal strip, or the triangular strip, depending on the type of problems given. So we will discuss that in detail as we go through. So let's just work out, work on different problems. So let's, first problem is that of a triangle. So triangle has a base of B and altitude or height equals to h. So we want to determine the centroid from the base by direct integration technique. So again, the procedure would be evaluate the total area first, that we can again do using the strips of our choice. But what is most interesting, in order to get the centroid from the base, that means we are interested in y bar from the base, what would be most appropriate? Do I choose a horizontal strip element, or do I choose a vertical strip? So that we have to be extremely careful. Remember, in this case, if I am trying to choose a vertical strip, then there is a discontinuity at this. So vertical strip, if we choose, we have to perform the integration along x direction, and there is a clear discontinuity here. So one function you have to adopt, one limit will be 0 to some value here, the other limit will be from here to this end. However, if I use a horizontal element, then it will be much easier to do the integration. So in this case, therefore, what we will do, we will choose a horizontal element. So let's look at this step by step. So first we evaluate the area. So area is nothing but integral of dA. So at a location y, we have chosen a strip. That strip has an width of depth of dy and the width of w. Now remember, this is infinitesimally small strip. So now what we have to find out, w as a function of y, and that we can easily calculate. How do I calculate w as a function of y? Remember, we can resort to the similar triangle analogy. So therefore, I have one triangle is this, the upper part of the rectangular horizontal element, and the other one itself is the large triangle. If we look at this, I can clearly see that w must be equals to b by h multiplied by h minus y. So we do the dy on this. So the limit goes from 0 to h. So I have the area b h over 2. So half b times h, which is a very well known solution. So now, in order to get the centroid, all I have to do, I have to first find the first moment about the x axis. So the first moment of this strip about the x axis should be simply y bar of this element. So I have to find out what is the, you know, centroid of this element from the x axis. So that is nothing but y, considering this is a very, you know, infinitesimally small strip. So therefore, we have y here directly, and the area will be w dy. So if we do this, then we are going to get b h square over 6. That's the first moment about the base. So to evaluate the centroid, we simply say y bar a equals to q x, and therefore we get the height equals to h by 3. Remember, it does not matter how I solve this problem. In all cases, I am always going to find, if I consider this to be my base, let's say, then I am always going to get h over 3 as my answer of the centroid from the base. So another problem, let's say we have A and B. Okay, so we define this area, we have to find out the area of this parabolic spandrel, okay, which is defined by this curve y equals to kx square. So what is first important, that we find out the value of k, right? Once we find out the value of k, we find out the total area, right? And then we can either choose, in this case, either a vertical strip or a horizontal strip, and simply take the first moments of that, so qx or qy, and evaluate the centroid based on the formula derived. So first, how do I find out the value of k? So determine the constant k. So remember, y equals to k x square. So we can clearly see that at, let's say, x equals to a, value is equals to, you know, y value is b. So from that, b equals to k square. So k equals to b, is b divided by a square. So I now have y completely defined in terms of b and a, or x can be also defined in terms of y. Okay. So to evaluate the area, we are simply going to take a vertical strip, right? So the vertical strip, remember, the area of the vertical strip is y dx, as we see here. So we'll substitute for y as a function of x, which we have done, and integrate from 0 to a. So that will give me area to be equals to ab by 3. So once I get the area, now I have to find out the centroid. So therefore, I will try to take the first moment of this rectangular element with respect to the x axis as well as with respect to the y axis. So as we can see, if I want to take the first moment of this area with respect to the y axis, so what is the centroidal distance of this small element from the y axis? It is simply equals to x, considering dx is very small. So we simply have x multiplied by the dA, dA is y dx, Now we can substitute y in terms of x, so we will find the value of qy. Okay. Similarly, to get the qx, that is the first moment of this area about the x axis, we see that y bar element, that is simply going to be equals to y divided by 2. So we integrate from, again y has to be substituted in terms of x because we are now operating along the x axis, our integration limit. So a b square over 10. So ultimately for this parabola, okay. So now another procedure is adopted here. If you really want to do this in terms of a horizontal strip, so we have done in terms of vertical strip. So the here the question is, if we really use the horizontal strip, do I get the same answer for the first moments or not? And we can try this out. We'll see. Now in this case, only thing that is happening, your x bar element is changed. Now what is the x bar element? Now we discussed that in the beginning also. X bar element will be simply a plus x divided by 2. So this is my x bar element of this horizontal strip, and the area of it dA should be equals to a minus x times dy, right. So now what we had to do, since now we are operating on y, right, so 0 to b is the limit, so we have to replace x in terms of y, okay. And once we do that, we are going to get the same answer. If you look at it, the previous one, using the vertical strip, we have this a square b over 4, and this one we also have the same. So first moment will remain same, and therefore it does not matter which way I solve this problem. So ultimate answer, now we are going to, you know, have the x bar a, so that's the equivalent system. So in the equivalent system, I am taking the first moment, right? So first moment of that area, total area, x bar a, I am trying to find out x bar, that is equals to qy, right? That's the first moment of this distributed area. So we get x bar equals to 3/4a, similarly y bar equals to 3/10b. So another problem. So this is more, you know, kind of interesting as well. Now here there are two curves. One is the linear function, as you see y equals to mx, and there is a parabola y equals to kx square. Okay. So we are interested in finding out what is the centroid of this area, the shaded area. So remember, as these distances are given, a and h, we should be able to first find out what is m and what is k. How we are going to find it out? So let's say that h equals to k a squared, so that means right here, right, at x equals to a, y equals to h, we substitute that, so we get the value of k. Similarly, for this function right here also, we can say at x equals to a, y equals to h, so we can get the m. Okay. So m and k can be known simply by saying at x equals to a, I know the function y. So how do I now choose the strip? Now I can either decide on a horizontal element or a vertical element. So in this case, a vertical element is chosen. Now if you choose the vertical element, the main point to note here, this vertical element will have two different heights. One height will be y1, right? So that y1 will be varying with this function y equals to kx square, and we will have another height y2, that y2 will be varying with this function as we move on x. Okay. So ultimately, if we look at the centroid of this particular element, so we look at x bar element, that is nothing but equals to x, and y bar of this element should be just equals to y1 plus y2 by 2. Okay, remember y1 and y2 we know in terms of x already because they are defined by two function. One function is y equals to mx, the other function is y equals to kx square. Okay. So now the area dA is nothing but y2 minus y1 multiplied by dx. So now you substitute y2 and y1 in terms of x, which you already know. So this is mx and this is k times x square. So this is my dA. So I can get the area. So area can be obtained by integrating between 0 and a. So that we get 1/6 of ah. So now we have to take the first moment, which is done here. So to do the first moment, again everything is described in the previous slides. So as we can see here, that we have to do x bar element multiplied by the dA. So that will be the first moment about the y axis, and similarly y bar element multiplied by dA, that will be the first moment about the x axis. So we are doing that separately and expressing y in terms of x, because we are operating on x integration limit. So we get this is the first moment about the y axis. Similarly, the first moment about the x axis, that we can get. Okay, remember here we have to do lot of substitution here because of the y bar element, which is y1 plus y2 by 2, and area is y2 minus y1 dx. Okay, so ultimately we have the first moments, this one and that one, about the two axes, and from that we can find out the x bar. So x bar a should be equals to q of y, first moment about the y axis, and y bar a is the first moment about x axis. So we should finally get x bar and y bar. Okay, now we are actually talking about a circular sector. Okay, so what is sector? So you can see here that sector is defined by this alpha. So it varies from, let's say, if this is my centroidal axis, that I for sure know, because it has actually symmetry about this line. So that will be described between negative alpha and positive alpha. So how do I get this? Okay, now in this case, it will be always wise or advisable to get a triangular strip, because now I want to perform in the polar, integration in the polar coordinate. So it will be always wise to get the triangular strip that is varying from negative alpha to the positive alpha. So this was explained also previously. Now only concern is here that, okay, what is the centroid of this triangular element? As we know that this distance from the vertex, right, of this triangular element, so this distance will be 2/3 of r. So r is the radius of the sector, right? So therefore my x bar element, x bar element is nothing but 2/3 r cosine of theta. Okay, so 2/3 r cosine theta, all right? And the area is also defined. Area is nothing but you have r d theta here, so that's the base. Height of the triangular element is nothing but r, so half multiplied by r d theta multiplied by r, so this is half r square d theta. So we get the area as simply, if we look at half r square d theta, and our integration limit goes from negative alpha to positive alpha, so alpha r square. Okay, so once we get the area, then we can talk about taking the first moment. So the first moment should actually be x bar multiplied by the area. Area is already found, r square alpha. That should be equals to, now you take the first moment of the element. So as we have seen, that x bar element is 2/3 r cosine theta. So x bar element multiplied by the dA, and integration should be negative alpha to positive alpha. So ultimately I am going to get 2/3 of r sine alpha by alpha. Okay. Now you can actually see that what happens if it's a semicircle. So for semicircle, what is my alpha? Alpha is simply going to be equals to pi by 2. So if I substitute alpha equals to pi by 2, then you can see the centroid from the base should be equals to 4r by 3 pi. Okay. So you can also consider the quarter circle, but you know, using the symmetry, the center, you know, from the base is always going to be equals to 4r by 3 pi. The question is, can we also solve this problem by taking an strip which is also arc? So if we choose a arc as an strip, can we solve it? Now this will give us, you know, little bit allow us to study also, if I really choose the arc as an element, then what is the centroid of that arc from the vertex? So just look at carefully what has been done here. So first thing that we can see now I am really going to, you know, work on a arc. So this arc is defined here and my integration will be from 0 to r. Okay, so now what is varying is that dr0. Okay, so r0 is a varying quantity and this r0, you know, coming to 0 as well as, you know, going to the r0. So ultimately to study this, we have to do little bit more exercise to find out the centroid of an arc. Okay, so how to find out the centroid of an arc? Remember we are discussing the centroid of lines, right? So here we really have an arc as a line and we are interested to find out what is the centroid of it. So now we look at this part of the, you know, slide, we do not go here at all. So let's try to find out, first of all, what is the length of this element, total arc. The length of the total element would be simply 2r alpha, right? Okay, that is one thing. Now you can clearly see that is my L. So L times x bar, I am trying to find out this x bar, should be equals to integral x bar dl. So dl, what is my dl? Dl in this case is r d theta. Okay, so r d theta is here and what is the centroid of this small little, you know, length l, dl rather? So that is going to be equals to r cosine theta. Okay, and integration is from negative alpha to alpha. So in this case, the first objective is to find out the centroid of this arc, a line element as an arc. So we are able to see that x bar equals to r sine alpha divided by alpha. Now this is now going to be introduced in this problem of an area, okay, because here we have chosen the arc as an element or strip, okay, and you can see the centroid of this element, centroidal distance of this element from the vertex, from the y axis is nothing but r0 sin alpha divided by alpha, which we have obtained from this. So now it is very simple. So what you got here is the area of this thing, right? So that is simply equals to alpha r square. So forget about this. So it is going to be alpha r square. Okay, that's the total area, right? And then we have x bar of this element, that is r0 sin alpha by alpha, right? And the dA of the element, dA of the element is nothing but 2r0 alpha dr0. So this is 2r0 alpha, 2 alpha r0, right, multiplied by dr0, that's the area of this strip. Okay, so once we do that, ultimately we are going to get the x bar. So that x bar will be 2/3 r sine alpha by alpha. So what we have essentially done in this case, we have looked at two different ways to solve this, you know, circular sector. And ultimately, we have two choices. One is the triangular strip that is going from, you know, that is operating on the theta. Integration limit will be on theta. So variable is theta here. And in this case, my variable is r0. So both ways, I can get the same answer as we see. So we always have a choice to choose those strips properly. However, depending on the problem, we have to be extremely careful. So now I think what has happened in the process, we have actually studied all of this. You can see clearly all these shapes, right? And we have studied all of this, no doubt. So their area is properly defined and their centroids are also defined here, okay? So this needs to be handy. In order to, you know, go to the composite sections, we need to have this data with us when we are going to study the composite sections. Similarly, we have worked on the parabolic spandrel, y equals to kx square. We have found these are the centroids, x bar, y bar. We have not studied this, but we can do as an homework exercise that what would be the centroids for a general, you know, parabolic spandrel of the order x to the power n. Circular sector we have also done from alpha to alpha. And I would really suggest that you write down this because this is going to be there in the tutorial also. So this number, please note down, 2r sine alpha divided by 3 alpha, or rather 2/3 r sine alpha by alpha, that is the centroid of this sector from the vertex. So vertex it at O. We just need this number later on, okay? So now for the composite plates and areas, so concept remains more or less same, but what we have learnt or what we have so far studied, that how to get the centroids of simple shapes. So by knowing the centroids of simple shapes, now we can look at the composite plates and areas, whereby we are going to discretize these shapes into known shapes, and therefore we know the centroids of individual areas in which we are discretizing the entire area. So let's say now what is the objective? Again, you are looking at two equivalent systems here. Remember, so I have the total area A. I want to find out what is the centroid of this total area. So therefore, what I am typically doing in this case, first break it into known shapes and their individual centroids are known with respect to corresponding, you know, axis, or let's say even x and y axis we will know, as long as we know from their base, let's say here, from base here, you know, for the rectangle we know it is at the centroid. So individual centroids are known. So essentially we are just equating the first moment of this with the first moment of this. So equate the first moment there is a mistype here, so there should not be, you know, here. I think there is a thing is misplaced. Let's work from here. So what happens in this case? So it should be x bar multiplied by wi, okay? And then you have x bar I and wi. So there is a wi. So this is the total w. Something is missing here. We'll just try to fix it. So ultimately you have x1 a1 plus x2 a2 plus x3 a3, that should be equals to x bar multiplied by sum over area. So this is correct, this expression correct. There is little bit of a problem right here as we can see. So just look at this, we are going to use this. So we are basically equating the first moment of this and that. So let's take this composite area now. So we are interested to find out the first moment with respect to the x and y axis, that is the first part of it. And then once we know the first moment, can I get the location of the centroid? Okay. Now to do that, as we have said, that we have to break it into many pieces. So how we are going to break it into different parts? So one way of doing it would be, let's say I take this triangular area below, then I can have a rectangular area, and on top of that I have the semicircular area. So three areas I can have, A1, A2 and A3, and at the end I can simply subtract the circular area from that. So what is being said here, find the total area and first moments of the triangle, rectangle and semicircle. Then subtract the area and first moment of the circular cutout. Okay? So compute the coordinates of the area centroid by dividing the first moments by the total area. So ultimately we are going to have four different areas. So now to do this, as you can see here, I have three different areas now here. But these are all added. So you can see the plus signs here. Okay, this plus this plus this. However, we have to take out this cutout. So we have to subtract this out. Okay, so it will be always advisable that we put together a small table in order to work on this problem. So the information that should have in this table, the table should have the information on the individual areas, okay, which we already know. For example, this one is nothing but 120 multiplied by 80, as you can see here. This shape has its own area written, this shape has its own area written, and this one has its own area, but remember we have to subtract that, so there is a negative sign, okay. So all areas are written, then the total area of the body is given by this. Okay. Now, in order to calculate the first moment, what we need to do, we have to find out the centroidal distance of individual components from the x and y axis. So what does x bar and y bar means? So it is coming with, you can see, and I here, right? So x bar, let's say 1, that is nothing but 60 from the y axis. Similarly, y bar 1 of the rectangle is 40 from the x axis. So then we get the first moment of this rectangle or area about the x axis. So x bar A, we get that, y bar A, it's there. Similarly, for the triangle, again very simple, what is the location of the centroid from the x axis, we all know, right? Should be this 60 divided by 3, okay, and this is 40 divided by 3. But remember, x bar and y bar has to be inserted based on their signs, because here y bar is on the negative y, okay. So therefore, we should put negative 20 for the triangle in the y bar, okay. Similarly for this, so what was it? So the centroid from the base was 4r over 3 pi, that we already know, it is marked. So 4r over 3 pi, that is from the base. Therefore, we can now calculate from the x axis. So from x axis, it will be 80, right? Plus, we have this small distance, which is 25.46, 4r over 3 pi. You can clearly see 105.46 is the number. So this is the distance of the individual centroid from the x axis. So likewise, we fill this with proper signs. So don't forget the signs. So once we do that, remember, now what we are going to do, we are simply going to get the x bar A, we are simply going to get the y bar A, right? Sum up all this. So these are the first moment, sum of first moment of the individual areas. So we have value of qx, qx is nothing but this one, and qy is nothing but this one. That's the first moment about the x axis, this is the first moment about the y axis. So once we get that, then we go to the next slide. So all we had to do, now we are trying to find out the centroid. So x bar of the entire area, so x bar multiplied by the total area should be equals to this. Similarly, y bar multiplied by the area should be equals to this, and that is how we will get the x bar and y bar. So, ultimately we can see the x bar will be equals to 54.8 mm and y bar will be equals to 36.6 mm. Okay. So, in this session we have taken up the simple exercises. However, as we can see that we have really looked at various aspects of direct integration, because what is really important for us to deliver to students are the concepts of direct integration. How should they perform the integrations on simple elements, simple areas, and how should they choose various types of strips, such as horizontal strip, it could be vertical strip, it could be triangular strip, or it could be even an arc. So, we have studied all of these problems and tried to solve the centroids of simple areas using the direct integration method. And then we have studied the composite plate case, whereby we have taken the known results of the individual areas. But remember, in the composite plates, one has to be careful with the signs. Okay. So, if we are subtracting area, that should go as negative. If x bar and y bar of the individual centroids are not on the positive quadrant, so we have to take the negative and positive signs accordingly. But it is always advisable that we put a clear table with all the information that are required, and thereby we can find out the centroids of composite area as well. So, the concept was really based on the equivalence system, that how we get into the business of locating the centroids of as individual elements as well as the composite plates. Okay. So, any questions you have, anyone in the yes, 1 to 5, 6.
Vector cross product, the determination, yes. Finding the determination, that explanation was missing there. I didn't understand that. Over to you.
The cross product was what we have discussed in the previous session, right? What was missing?
The explanation about finding the determinant.
Yes. So, you basically have ij, you have two vectors, right, p and q. We want to do the vector product of that, right? So, now you have basically, instead of doing I cross I cross j, j cross a, k, like that, we are simply looking at in a matrix form. So, on the first row I have the unit vectors I, j, k. In the second row I should put the p x, p y and p z. In the third row I have q x, q y and q z. Once we get the determinant of that, see, instead of doing component wise, the idea is you list like that, and therefore, the determinant would be the solution for the moment. Okay. So, r cross f, right, that is the main objective here. Okay. So, basically you put the r in one row, the components of r, and the f in one row. So, second row should have r, and the last row should have f, and at the beginning you have I, j and k on the first row. Okay. See, you can also do it one at a time. You see my point, like r 1 cross p 1, then again the way we use the distributive property, we can use the distributed property, but that will be lengthy process. Okay. Instead of that, we are just putting it in a matrix form, and then we get the moment from there. Clear?
Thank you.
Reva Institute of Technology, 1224.
Yes. Hello. Hello. My question is, many times the centroid is outside the lamina. Can you clarify? The students will always ask the doubt, how can it be outside the lamina?
Yes. So, your question is that when the centroids are outside the lamina. See, what we are talking here about the distributed mass. Ultimately, it is a distributed mass over the body, right? Now, depending on the shape, what we are trying to say, the first moment, if, see, remember, the main idea here is that the first moment should be 0 about the centroidal axis. Now, remember, to do that, suppose I choose, now this is, you know, kind of problem, I will just go to the slide little bit, then it will be much clearer. Remember, I talked about a, you know, L-shaped cross section, there was a L-shaped cross section, it is a L-shape, right? In that one, if we look at it carefully, their centroid will be outside that angle, you know, the angle cross section we talked about, that centroid will be outside. Question is why? See, when we are doing XDA, see, you have to have the moment from one side should balance the moment from the other side. See, that is the main issue here, such that your first moment is equals to 0 about the centroidal axis. Now, how the area is distributed, it can always fall even outside the shaded area or outside the lamina, as you are asking. So, basically you are trying to divide the area, not just dividing the area, but dividing the area in such a way that first moment becomes 0 about the centroidal axis. So, it is always possible that the centroid could lie outside the lamina. Is that clear? This is, yeah, 1295 from Hyderabad, Geetham University.
Yes, good evening sir, very good evening. It's very nice to listen lectures from you, from an eminent faculty from IIT. Sir, it's very useful for us. Sir, I need a fundamental clarification on the very concept.
Yes.
To find out, CG is told to be a point about which the object is supported, right? Now, to find out that location of CG, how do we justify using the very concept of area multiplied by a distance from a particular reference point? How do we justify using this particular principle to find out the CG? Could you please elaborate on?
Okay, it's a, see, as I said, see, the whole concept. So, your question is, what is the concept of finding the center of, you know, centroid rather, okay? So, first what we have studied is the equivalent system. So, typically what we are trying to study here is that I have, let us say, I have a distributed weight, right, on a body. Now, I want to find out where is the resultant or what is the net weight through which it passes. So, what I am trying to do here, I am just proposing two systems that are equivalent in nature. One is my original body where I have the distributed weight, right, which is proportional to the area, small area, and I have another system where I have the net weight with the total area. Is that clear? So, these are my two equivalent systems. Now, all I am saying that their first moment should be equal. So, that is the concept. Because if this is a their equivalent system, then they should have the same resultant moment. So, ultimately, I am simply equating the moment of the those two systems to get the centroid location. Is that clear? Concept comes from really the equivalent system. Because ultimately, remember, no matter what kind of force system I have, their resultant system, that means the equivalent system should be defined by a resultant force and a resultant moment. Now, in this case, I don't have a resultant moment. Why? Because I am talking about a parallel force system now. You see my point? So, you have a parallel force system because your weight and you have the planar area and you have the weight, right? So, your resultant force and the resultant moment, they are perpendicular to each other. Therefore, I should always be able to replace that by a single equivalent load, which is the net weight of the body. Clear? So, I am simply equating the moment of these two about the two axes to find the centroid.
Sir, I really thank you very much to clearing me this particular concept, but another clarification I do need on a particular section is that angle section. as one of the colleagues from other institutions has mentioned, the CG for L section is falling out of the cross-sectional area.
Yes.
If I have to design a section using only angle combinations, but how do I justify? Because I have no point on the cross-section to support it. How do I?
No. See, that's a different, altogether that's a different issue. See, if you want to apply the force, right? See, this is a typical problem even in civil engineering. Let's say you have two channel sections, right? So, even in a channel section, we try to find the shear center. That will be always outside the body. Typically speaking, now when you are trying to apply the load, actual load on the structure, then you have to add some small member to it that is going to hold the load. But remember, the contribution from that small element that is supporting the load will not affect your ultimate solution. So, these concepts are also delivered in solid mechanics. So, your question is absolutely valid reason that ultimately, see, what we are trying to essentially do here, I don't see that weight, you know, actually applied on the body. So, it is somewhere there, right? But in a actual system, how I apply that load? Then we have to make an appropriate connection to add that load in that area, okay? So, centroid can be, you know, outside that region, but to make the, you know, to put the load, if the problem demands that, then we have to make some additional connections. It's a very typical problem if you are looking at a, you know, a beam. Let's say I have a beam and I want to prevent that from the twisting. If I want to prevent the beam from the twisting, then it is required to put the load on the shear center. So, for a channel cross section, I have shear center also, which is outside the, you know, channel cross section. Then you have to make a special arrangement to put the load, okay?
Sir, one more question from Geetham University only.
Yes.
Finding the centroid of that sector.
Yes.
In sector, that in one case we considered a triangular strip.
Mm-hmm.
In triangular strip, the base is not a straight line, sir, but it is an arc. So, we considered it as a base for finding area of that. Actually, it is an arc, sir, but we should take the length as arc.
Yes. Because it's an infinitesimally. So, your question was, that when I am considering the circular sector, I am choosing a strip which is of the shape of an arc, right? Remember that strip has a width of dr0, which is very small, right? So, ultimately, if I know the centroid of that arc, right, what is the location of the centroid, then I can take the first moment. So, what I have done first find the centroid of that arc, okay? So, we find the centroid of that arc and then we can simply take the first moment and do the integration on the R0. That is what it was done. Clear? So, first you have a line element. Remember, you have a line first. We find the centroid of that line, okay? And then we take that information in order to find out the centroid of the area. Clear? 1032.
Hello, sir. My question is that when we take the moment of a force about an arbitrary axis, we take moment of the force about the point and then multiply it with unit vector along that axis.
Yes.
But we have we can have another approach to it, that is finding the length of common perpendicular between the force and the axis, which is nothing but the lever arm. And then we can multiply with the magnitude of the force.
Yes.
But both approaches are valid, but they give a different answer. Why?
No, they won't. So, your question is, your question is when you take the moment of a force about an axis, about an arbitrary axis, right? Now, you are trying to say you have one approach is the vector lambda dot r cross f. The other one is the f time the perpendicular distance. Is that what your question is, right? So, there are two approaches. So, remember in the first approach, what we are essentially doing, we are taking the moment of the force first about a point, right? So, that gives me the moment about that point. Now, I am simply taking the projection of that moment onto the line lambda. So I have lambda dot m not 0, lambda dot m, right. So that will give me the scalar solution for the moment about that axis. So your next question was, do I get a different answer if I do based on f multiplied by d? Absolutely not. Why should you get a different answer? As long as you calculate that d, you know, the calculation of that d is not trivial. See, that's the whole problem, because you need to do lot of, you know, in that will involve lot of mathematics to find out the perpendicular distance from the axis to the force. But you should not get a different answer. That's absolutely not desired. Okay.
Yes, sir. Because when I tried this one, I got a slightly different. It's not completely different, but slightly different answer. That's why I wanted to.
No. You think of a simple problem. Maybe in 2D planar case, you know, you should not have a different answer. It's not possible. Okay, we go to move to. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.